The following program contains mature themes, which may not be appropriate for young children. Parental discretion is advised.
Yeah.
Man, that dude, what the hell's his name? Mo showed up with this chick at Ford Field. I could not keep my eyes off of her, man.
Nice.
My boy Mo?
Yeah.
Shout out Mo.
He shows up with this chick and I took a picture, but the picture doesn't do her justice at all. She was stunning. Me, the idiot, she sticks out her hand when he introduces her, and I grab both hands, and with the top hand, I start like petting the top of her hand like I'm in fucking love, a sick little puppy dog. It's like, holy nice. Shit, I got to get back into my cave. I can't be allowed out. Gorgeous woman. I went over to buy them drinks, and I'm just staring at her body while I'm at the bar. I said, holy shit, what's wrong with me?
Oh. I was Mo. Mo, a character?
Mo is, like, so fucking cool. It, like, the other side of the pillow cool. I mean, this guy is just fucking slick. He just drips nice. With coolness.
He's a pimp.
Oh, big time. Big time. Yes. Now, I gotta tell you this. The guy that Bears Girl brought to the game, I mean, really nice guy. I mean, he and I could be buddies for the rest of our lives, but motherfucker can talk? Holy shit. He would not shut the fuck up. And on the
Is
way
he
up.
Is Canadian too?
Yeah, he's Canadian. On the way
yeah,
up.
Yeah, those motherfuckers talk so fast.
Oh my gosh. And just would not shut the fuck up. On the way up there, my daughter and I are listening to music, and every once in a while I'll play this.
Oh my God, who the hell cares?
And so every time the guy was talking, that was playing in my fucking mind. Just over and over again. Oh. I'm so looking at Bears Girl. I'm like,
put this on the show. You're saying,
yeah, I don't know. I'm recording. I don't know if I want to post this. But I'm looking at Bears Girl, and I'm like, are you kind of getting the same vibe that this motherfucker won't shut up? But she was kind of oblivious to it. I don't know, man.
She
I was sticking to myself.
She's grown accustomed to it.
Yeah, yeah, really.
I think that's a Canadian thing, big time. Because yeah. I know a few of them, and they just are non. They're fucking relentless. They
oh
do
my
not
God.
Stop.
They're fucking lonely or something up there. So goddamn cold, I guess. But I could not do 5 hours in a car with that guy. No fucking way.
No, fuck that.
I'm blasting the music, man.
Glennon got pushed over by a chemist, standing on the sideline at domain. You can say that's not such a big deal, but us in the barroom disagree. Glennon is a waste of millions. All the barflies know it's true. Hicks showed great resilience by shoving and not using his kung fu. Yeah. Glennon was sore the next morning. From that one shelf to his back. But the barflies were still laughing at his knee pass interception to the pack.
Oh.
Glennon got pushed over by a chemist, standing on the sideline that don't mean. You can say there's not such a big deal, but us in the barroom disagree. All that wasted free agent money, the barroom dubbed it the giraffe gap. But there isn't anything funny about blowing millions on his half-ass. It's a little better in the barroom now that Glennon's on the bench. And we sit and pray and wonder on Black Monday, God, please make John Fox next. Glennon got run over by a chemist, standing on the sideline like a tree. You all think that it didn't matter, but us at the barroom disagree. Now my Glennon's still a captain. Off the bus, the guy's so big. on the center, it ain't cheap. I've warned all the barflies, thought Pace could see it for himself. They should never sign a QB who's over 6'5" in the NFL. Glennon got pushed over by a key miss. Standing on the sideline, that don't mean. You could say that's not such a big deal, but us in the bar room disagree. Glennon got pushed over by a key miss. Standing on the sideline, that don't mean. You could say that's not such a big deal, but us in the barroom disagree. Us in the barroom disagree.
We have to be more efficient passing the ball. If you look at it statistically as a football team, I mean, you know, we're ninth in the league in defense, 12th in points. That should win you more games than what we're at. You know, when you look at our offense, we're 28th in points, you know, 30th overall. You know, in the top 10 in rushing, but the bottom three in passing, so I'd just leave it at that.
I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fired John Fox today. Refs are flagging, no challenge having, all ain't dandy and bright. So hang a loss and play conservative and fire Coach Fox tonight. I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fire John Fox today. Refs are flagging, no challenge having, all ain't dandy and bright. So hang a loss and play conservative and fire Coach Fox tonight.
Leave it at that.
I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fire John Fox today. No more lies at Hallis Hall, can't take it all again. To see the presser with Teddy Pace, all is smiling and bright. Can't take the losing and media schmoozing and fire Coach Fox tonight. I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fire Coach Fox today. Virginia get mad again, no one is glad again, close to Black Monday. Peace in the barroom will come if they follow the light. So jump on stage, George, and no excuse made and fire Coach Fox tonight. I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fire Coach Fox today. Refs are flagging, no challenge having, all ain't dandy and bright. So hang a loss and play conservative and fire Coach Fox tonight. I hate John Fox, I hate John Fox, fire George Fox today. Virginia get mad again, no one is glad again, close to Black Monday. Peace in the barroom will come if they follow the light. Jump on St. George, no excuse made, and fire Coach Fox tonight.
You know,
leave it at that. Cheers, Bears fans! This is Bears 100 Proof. That was head coach John Fox mumbling and grumbling his way through another press conference, but the word is he is probably less than 2 weeks away from being the former head coach of the Chicago Bears. If indeed Fox is fired on Black Monday, which this year happens on January 1st, it will be the perfect way to start the new year. My name is Aldo Gandia, but don't you worry, the stars of this nightclub act are here, and they are, of course, Shayne, the smartest man in the barroom, Marsaw, and draft Dr. Phil Ottochian, the music genius behind all of the Bears parody Christmas songs that we've been playing here at the barroom. Well, I know that your music producing plate is full, and I know that Shane no longer wants to be your muse, but I think you need to start working on a parody song that we can release the day John Fox is fired, and I think I can help. Let's do something with Pharrell's Happy, and I took the liberty of doing the chorus. Take a listen.
Oh, boy.
Do a shot if you feel like Fox is a damn fool. Do a shot if you think that Firefox finally ruled. Do a shot if you're happy that Fox is finally gone. Do a shot and say goodbye to the dude who's a moron. Yeah, well, yeah, what do you think, fellas? What do you think?
I'm feeling this.
It's all yours now, Shane, Phil.
When's Shane's song coming out?
I got to admit, I think I can do a little bit better than Elvis.
the parody off 2018.
You're New on, Year's Shane. Day. You're on.
There we go. I will write the lyrics and you guys will perform. Barflies will unite. Votes will be cast. Nautica sweatshirts will be given out.
I think what we do is we do a little competition, and then the one that people like the most, we turn it over to you, and then you make it fucking solid gold hit.
There you go.
There we go. That's what we should do.
I'm in, man.
We might even get a celebrity duet. People lining up all over for the diva.
It's really the only chance I have of winning something, because I know Bears Girl is going to pick one of you two guys over me, and then this is all I'm fighting for.
Well, I listened to Bears Hour live last night. Phil was really laying it down pretty thick. Like I did the week before. So he was trying to one-up me since I couldn't be on with you guys last night. So got to see.
I got to take my shots when I get them.
Yeah.
Yeah, you did an excellent job of it. Shane sent a direct message to us this morning. He listened to Bears Hour live this morning, and he said, what was it, Shane? I don't want to mess it up.
Oh, no. I said, good show today, boys. Listened to it, enjoyed it. It was an hour and 15 minutes long. Aldo clicked in at 6 minutes and 17 seconds of total talk time. And Phil eloquently filled in the rest of the show. I wasn't kidding. I'm like, motherfucker's never going to shut up. Oh, my God. What are you, Canadian? Jesus, dude.
Dude, it's my show. What am I supposed to do?
Aldo just got my joke.
I got your joke. I don't want to give any clues.
Oh, I'm going to have to include that.
I don't want
to
get our boss in trouble.
It's too late. It's too late. I'm forced to include that at the beginning of the show now.
And now you'll know. I'll put it right here.
The more you know.
Let's go back to the beginning of the show.
All right. Who wants the first question today? Because I got.
It's got to be Shane.
It's got to be Shane.
Since I talked for what? How many minutes was it again?
Well, it was an hour and 15 minutes of total talk time for the entire show. But Aldo clocked in at 6 minutes and 17 seconds.
So, I'm not good at math.
Math-wise,
that's over 100% that Phil did, right?
If you sit back and replay that Bears Hour live show, you can hear Aldo in the background just slamming his keyboard. I think maybe
he was active on the
You're drinking some, and like Phil's going. The one point Phil stopped, took a couple breaths, and he's like, "Well, then anyway, there's one more thing," and he. Aldo, I'm sorry to step on you, but I just got to tell you one more thing. And then he talked for another 35 minutes.
And you fucking loved every minute of it. Stop.
I did.
It was excellent radio.
You are a sexy bitch.
I got to step up in the pocket. When our celebrity mailman doesn't show up. I thought he was clocking in at the end of the show.
I was going to try, but we ran into some bad weather last night up here.
Phil reminds me of Dan Marino, who never wanted to fucking hand off the ball.
He didn't even want to spike it. He's never, like, fuck right. it. I'm just going to throw it. Fake spike, throw another one in there.
There's 10 guys dropping back in pass coverage. Fuck this. I'm throwing.
Yeah.
Awesome. All right, Shano, I got a question here. Is there any chance whatsoever, that John Fox is coaching the Chicago Bears in 2018? I mean, you know, we have to talk about it, right? Because while everybody feels like he's a dead man walking, these are the Chicago Bears that we're talking about. What do you think?
Well, I guess you can never say never. So, like you said, especially when you're talking about this Bears franchise, but Aldo, holy fuck. If that happens, I mean, you're wasting a complete second year of your potential franchise quarterback, and you are essentially taking a big shit on your fan base. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is going to be the biggest off season on record since last year, you know, for Ryan Pace. You know, he got the quarterback, and this offseason has to be about surrounding him with weapons. And if for some reason they made that determination that John Fox is the best guy to do that moving forward, I mean, you're essentially punting on your entire offseason, anything with your fans, your potential free agents know that John Fox would essentially be a lame duck. I'm sure Dowell would have to be the scapegoat at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, you talk about Armageddon type situation. I mean, that we didn't see rock bottom with Mark Trestman. If this happens, I mean, that would be in my lifetime. I'm 41 years old. If they bring back John Fox, you have to blow this bitch all up. I mean, send Trey to Hallis Hall and let him do whatever the fuck he's got to do to send a message. But, oh, my God, I just – there's no way I can see Ryan Pace hitching his wagon to this toxic, you know, vehicle that we've been on the last 3 years. I mean, I'm sure we'll get into it a little bit, but you're talking about – you know, the third consecutive year of the popularity vote with the Pro Bowl, where there's been no, you know, Chicago Bears on the initial roster. Yes, Howard and Hicks will probably be, you know, first alternates and will likely end up being there. But you got to, you know, Mitch Trubisky is the guy that's giving this fan base, this franchise, a little bit of hope. And if you bring back John Fox, you're pouring water on your fans and on the little bit of fire that would be left with this franchise. It's just, I mean, you talk about a shitty start to a new year, 2018, bringing back John Fox. Jesus Christ. I hope not.
Yeah. It almost goes beyond the possibility of comprehension that would happen. But man, there is a part of me that believes that anything can happen. Phil, what are your thoughts? I mean, are you going to fly in and pick it with me in front of Hallis Hall if that happens?
Honestly, I don't know how. I can't even think consciously that, you know, weeks ago I was told by someone I trust that, oh, this is done. And it was very clear to them that this was a foregone conclusion. You know, the question of why not then obviously was my next response. Something obviously that we all would love to know, why not? And there was no answer given. And we all stressed out about it. But to even conceptualize, which, you know, Shane hit it out of the park, it was exactly what we talked about on 100 Proof. The damage that's being done to this quarterback and this team just by the coaching. That's why I took such a time period last night to make sure the emphasis is on the position. You know, if one person could combat stupidity above them, it would be the head coach. And really keeping this guy in service and whatever – communications and all of us and every person I have ever talked to wondering, did Ryan Pace hire John Fox? Is that relationship okay? And it's been a tug of war, really, from both sides to know what that is. So I just can't even fathom the thought process behind keeping him. I totally would, to answer your question fully, I mean, that would motivate me to spend money, but really, ultimately, I would have to ask the bar flies to unite in the area to get down there, because there would be a riot, just like our song, Palace Hall is going to fall down if
it's
they keep this guy. You know, on Black Monday, his name should be the first one heard. Shouldn't even, the rumor should start on the night before.
Yeah, it should happen on the plane trip back.
Yeah,
to right. Chicago from right. Minnesota. I mean, let's be honest. It's, I mean, guys, we're all diehards here. I mean, we've been through thick and thin and a lot of thin with this team lately. But can you, I mean, everybody wants a little bit of hope. We got a little bit of that when we finally saw them draft a quarterback. You know, it kind of reinvigorates you about this entire, you know, long offseason, this entire process. It brings you some hope. And that would just be the ultimate fuck you to the Chicago Bears masses, to the barflies, to us, to just Bears fans throughout the world that don't listen to this show even. It would be the ultimate fuck you. And you cannot tell me that a guy like Mitch Trubisky, we've seen it with our own eyes, guys, him in the press conferences where he's almost downtrodden. Like I mentioned before, as a little kid, you're dreaming every night about playing in the NFL, and then Mitch gets here and he's like, is this real? You know, I threw seven passes today. This is what's going on. And I would really have to relook my whole process with this team if they were that absolutely inept that that was the path.
How would you go forward?
Chose. I'm not sure.
I don't know how you sell that, Shane. Like, in front of us, there would be a riot at this point. I mean, the stupidity is never say never. Just like I said last night, they could turn around and fire Pace for all I know. Who the fuck is running the show? Is it Ernie Accorsi? All of a sudden, he's the guy behind the scenes? Well, we don't fucking know. We don't know. Ernie could have hired this guy, and it seems as does. All the connections fit. From what I was told, that's what transpired. So what happens next? Oh, you know what? You better fucking cut the cord now, because he's whatever.
Yeah.
I just don't.
A couple of weeks ago, Phil, I brought up on here that I think that there's probably a lot more detailed process to this that we're not privy to yet. You know, I compared it to the Mitchell Trubisky cloak and dagger, you know, private detective work and smoke and mirrors and all that stuff. And I know that I get painted as the ultimate fan, Ryan Pace fanboy. And
number one Adora.
Yeah, right.
Slaying them tweets cross-eyed.
It is what it is.
Before.
But can anybody sit there with a clear conscience and just, don't you think that Ryan Pace has to know exactly where he's going and has known it for quite a while at this point in the off? I mean, it's pretty obvious it's not happening in season, and that's most likely a mistake, but if he's sitting there and is, you know, flying, you know, just by the wayside with this and is going to figure out what's going on after the season, then obviously he's not the guy. But I mean, for him to be so detailed and so committed to
Shane,
finding his quarterback.
Where is he? Like, why isn't he? Like, say what
know.
You want about Jerry Angelo. He gave some great quotes and funny shit and made himself look stupid sometimes. But the one thing nobody can deny is the guy put his face to his team. He stood out there and answered the hard questions, dealt with these clowns, because there's still some of the same fucking clowns in the media. He became a punchline for them. And granted, maybe that's why they're hiding Pace, so he doesn't, but I mean, show your fucking face in this miserable season.
I think there's a lot of it too, Phil, where you have to, and I agree, Ryan Pace should make himself available, not to, to a guy like Jeff Joniak. And obviously, hopefully this is coming up in the next couple of weeks. But, you know, we just went through this with Phil Emery. There was no other general manager that was more readily available to the media than Phil Emery was. I mean, he loved to hear himself talk. He would be out there talking all the time. And, I mean, that also didn't bring us anything. But, no, I do agree, and that's a red mark against Ryan Pace, absolutely, because you have to own this. Is this way of Ryan Pace's way of saying, I mean, there's been some reports of tension between he and Fox, you know, along the way, where they've had some disagreements, and then Pace possibly not letting Fox know about the Trubisky pick. Is this Ryan Pace's way of saying, you know, you're the head coach of this team, and you're going to finish it, and then on Black Monday, you're out of here? But no, it's a bad look for the franchise. It's a bad look for Ryan Pace. John Fox just makes himself look worse every single week when he gets out there. I mean, he's a Bears girl. We talked, in DMs today with each other. He's like just a stammering old man at this point. You know, I think
Does your wife know about these DMs?
No. I said with all of us.
Did you hear that, Aldo?
I did. What's going on there?
DMs.
This guy's been busy.
With all babies. Of us. Our creative DMs here. But,
speak English.
A little bit.
Well, here's the thing, guys, is the one question Ryan Pace does not want to answer is, will you give John Fox a vote of confidence for 2018? So that's why he's avoiding the media, because he doesn't want to answer that question. Now, what he should have done was, in the bye week, he should have had a mid-year press conference and answered questions. Mm-hmm. At that time, the team was actually kind of pointing up. People were expecting, you know, a victory against the Packers the following week. They had won two of their last three games. The game in New Orleans was close. And the fact that he didn't face the media, that is, at that point, that's what I hold against him more than not facing the media over the last several weeks. The other thing is...
Yeah, but because he skipped that, Aldo, let me just ask you. Because he skipped that media sweet spot, if you will,
right?
Now that the fucking train is off the tracks,
mm-hmm.
these fans are all asking everybody for a fucking answer.
Yep.
And if the Bears barroom, who kills the truth every single time,
mm-hmm.
can't give it to you, what the fuck is going on? Adam John's trying to sneak a fucking question about, do you think Mitchell needs another year with you, helping him through this? What the fuck? I mean, just come out and ask, Coach, are you safe?
Yeah, what right, exactly.
What are you...
They have asked him that a couple of times, how he feels about
and he says he doesn't give up.
And that's what he says. I don't give a rip.
Are you fucking safe? Is this it for you?
Mm-hmm.
That's it.
There's different ways to ask the question, and I wish it would be asked more often, even to the point of if you get sick of it.
Oh,
that's all right. That's all right. The other thing is, in terms of, you know, Fox knowing, the point that Shane makes, which I think is a good one, what is Ryan Pace doing now? Well, he cannot talk to another agent about a guy who is employed. He can send out signs that things might change in Chicago, but he cannot risk talk to another agent, because if that agent then goes to the media, a hell will break over. It will be as sloppily handled as the Dave McGinnis pseudo hire. So he's got to be very, very careful. Now, what I would do at this point is either after the Browns game or before the final game against the Vikings, you tell John Fox you're going to be replaced on January 1st. Yep. I'm telling you now, that way when you address to your players, if you want to, you know, mm-hmm. give your final speech and final goodbyes and tell them to win one for you, you have that opportunity. But as a gesture of you know, being your friend, not just your boss, you are going to be fired, and I want to give you an opportunity to talk to your guys.
Yeah, no, I think that's a – that's it.
Well, it's a pro's way of handling
it. Exactly. But you know what we see in Chicago? How many media releases have we seen at 2:30 or 3 a.m.? You know what I mean? Yep. That's the way that they seem to work at Halas Hall.
Worst fucking media.
Phil, way back in the day, back when they broke the news on Tressman, you and I were, the early days of Twitter, not the early days of Twitter, but it wasn't the big thing that it is now. We're on there talking about it while it wasn't even out there that we had some heads up that this guy from Montreal was going to be named the next head coach of the Chicago Bears. And people were, you know, banging on us and just saying, oh, you don't know what you're talking about, blah, blah, blah. And then lo and behold, 3:30 in the morning, the news, Brad Briggs breaks the news that Mark Trestman's going to be the next head coach of the Chicago Bears at 3:30 a.m. That seems to be a classic procedure.
I thought it was Aaron Lemon at 2:29 a.m.
Yeah, I think he was still working at Borders then.
Aaron Lemming. You're going to have to make a song, a parody song about Aaron Lemming, just devoted to him.
If you're a barfly and you follow Aaron, that's fine. Going to say this one more time. Yeah. I don't care what Aaron Lemming, his coaching list, he's gathered names, studied other people's lists, and came up with his mixed up list to make himself look like Zahn. This guy's a fucking nerd fraud, and that's what's happening.
And you're being nice, okay. All right.
Exactly. Shane's boy.
Yeah, yeah.
They go way back.
He's actually your creation. I think you set those wheels in motion.
I know. I fucking created a monster there, huh? This is the guy that told me, Willie Young, he fucking can't play. He's awful. Willie Young won't survive in a 4-3 scheme. He won't. Then, when he fucking had 10 sacks and they switched to a 3-4 scheme, he tells me, well, you know, he did surprise me. You were right. Never could admit that out there. But he can't play in a 3-4 scheme. And I go, dude, Fangio's scheme is a... he's an underlook. He's going to play D end and give you four-man fronts. He's going to be able to move and drop it. He totally can because he can rush the path. Anyway, you know the story. That's what you're dealing with there. Someone who doesn't know football, someone who finds out stories or whatever, that's cool. That's their job.
Right.
Adam Schefter doesn't know more about football than the next guy. He just knows a lot of connections and we'll tell you who's signing first.
You're making an excellent point. There's too many guys out there who should just stick to reporting. Report the news. Don't give us your opinion because you don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, it irks me to no end. I know Shane gets even more fired up than me, if you could believe it, because he gets me fucking amped up by poking the bear over here.
He has fun doing that.
Shane knows how to push your buttons.
I do.
I know. I go, this guy knows how to push everybody's fucking buttons.
He does. That is so true. Hey, guys, I wanted to play a Fox soundbite from, Monday's press conference. And, you know, for once, I thought that Fox made sense. And this was a much ridiculed sound bite in Twitter and members of the media because Fox sounded critical of Trubisky after the game. But after watching the tape, he applauded Trubisky's performance. And I want us to all listen to it. And frankly, I thought that for the first time in a long time, I actually heard John Fox making sense. Now, I think I got the right one queued up here. I wasn't planning on playing this, but I thought this might be kind of cool to listen to. So here it comes.
You know, I think that's a good question, because even at the end of the game, I think, you know, when you go back and you look at the tape, you go through the mechanics, you go through the decision-making. There was really a lot of good that Mitch did. You know, I don't know that fans and everyday people that don't get a chance to study the tape and kind of know what he's been taught and told. You know, everybody looks at the box score, they see the three picks, you know. But, you know, probably arguably his best game. You know, the thing that I think is impressive about Mitch is, you know, there was a couple situations where we might not have been lined up right. He corrected it. We had a situation where a guy's lined up wrong. He corrected it. 3-4 weeks ago, I'm not sure that happens. You know, there was a couple of throws where, I mean, mechanically he's really sound. He's staring down the barrel with, you know, somebody right in his face, you know, and drills a completion, you know, on 3rd and 18. So there was really a lot of good. I mean, I know the result's not what everybody wants. I understand that. But as far as his growth and his maturation, I thought probably his best game. As far as just him goes, I think obviously the pick in the end zone. I know he'd like to have that one back. There weren't a lot of options, but you throw it away. But one thing I've seen about Mitch, you know, we even had a screen pass the other day where it was pretty well defended. You know, we didn't avoid quite good enough, but he spiked it instead of trying to make something happen and throw it down the field, which is something he had done the week prior. So. You know, guys are going to make mistakes. You just don't want to make the same ones. And I've been very impressed with him as it relates to that.
Am I right or am I wrong? Did this guy finally make some sense?
No, you know, Aldo, when he first came out with that, there was I agree with your thought on that. And Phil and I talked about this over the phone yesterday a little bit about Mitch. A lot of fans out there are going to look at those three interceptions and just say, well, you know, Trubisky sucks and the Bears are horrible. And if you're a Deshaun Watson fan or a fan of another rookie quarterback, then, yep, see, Trubisky, he's threw those three picks. Well, let's just go back to the whole draft process, and we even questioned it here. You know, I had Mitch Trubisky as my number four quarterback in the draft, and I can readily admit that, and it is what it is at this point, to use a John Foxism. But when we saw him on TV with John Gruden, Aldo, I specifically remember you saying it kind of made you worried a little bit because everything looked too big for him. He kind of seemed very timid and, very sheepish. And does everybody remember what's a hard count? Hey, Mitch Trubisky doesn't know what a hard count is. Well, guess what? He knew what a hard count was on Sunday because he drew Detroit offsides two times with his hard count.
Yeah.
And you know what that's called? And you may not think that it matters, but it absolutely does matter. That's called progress. And this is what John Fox is talking about. I don't think you see that 4 weeks ago. And I think he's 100% right. You see him being a little more calm and moving the guys and pointing things out. The interceptions are going to happen. Peyton Manning threw 28 interceptions as a rookie. Andrew Luck, I think they said he threw 18. Mm-hmm. You know, Carson Wentz started off fine. He threw, I think, 14 as a rookie. The interceptions are going to happen, but it's all the little nuances around that are actually way more important at this point. You know, you want to get that good base moving forward. And I think this is where you're seeing, what do we, Josh Sitton say, you know, Mitch has no problem coming into the huddle and saying, hey guys, shut the fuck up. This is my huddle. You're going to listen to me. Quit, you know, dicking around, listen to what I'm saying. Little things like that are showing the progress. The interceptions, that doesn't mean Mitch Trubisky sucks. That means that you're a box score scout. That's all that means. If you could watch that game versus Detroit and tell me that you didn't see some elite level throws from Mitch Trubisky, I don't know what the fuck you were watching. I saw him, and I had him
watching
number,
the game.
Right. I had him as my number four quarterback in the draft, and I saw some elite-level throws in that. Did he make mistakes? Yes, he did. That's what you're going to get from an inexperienced quarterback making his 10th start in the NFL. That's going to come. But like I said, the little nuances, the hard count, the you know, taking command of the huddle, lining guys up right, like John Fox says, that's more important. And I do agree with what John Fox said for once.
Well, because you heard him tell the truth. He was just speaking upon a player that he can absolutely just tell the truth, because obviously there's some sort of line there between the interceptions, like you're talking about, the stat scout. They go on that line, and the fantasy football scout goes on that line, but the tape studier recognizes the situation and what transpired in coverage, or a guy didn't run his route to the right depth, which causes a quarterback that's anticipating a throw to put it somewhere where this receiver should just be a skip and a catch, whereas opposed now it looks bad. These things to me are why you're taking these reps, why you're playing these games. And also, as I said last night, you can't have it both ways. You know, you can't figuratively say, well, he's down to his third string guard, who's really a tackle playing guard, and a center having to move over to play guard because the center backup third round pick sucks. And now he's got to deal with that piss poor play up front, which is going to affect you as a, your center alone is going to affect you. Now your center's moving to guard. You follow what I'm saying? So all that stuff is what Coach Fox was talking about him. Making mistakes. We talk about it. How do you learn? By correcting your mistakes, by learning from them. How do you improve? You make plays. You get players in the right place. Errors on other players shouldn't affect it, but they do. And really, ultimately, when I watch that tape, Shane, I'm right there fucking with you.
Yeah,
I'm excited about this young quarterback.
I am too, Phil. And that's the thing that bothers me the most about this whole process. And I know that we have our presence on Twitter, and there's people that disagree with us, and that's fine. That's what it's all about. This entire thing is all about debate, and that's healthy. But I'm telling you right now, I had him as my fourth quarterback in the draft. It doesn't mean that I can no longer praise Mitchell Trubisky for playing well. It doesn't mean that I can't Mitch, a couple of those interceptions were bad balls. And I put it on Twitter. I said that's just a bad throw. And I had people coming after me on Twitter. Oh my God. You know, Jay Cutler made a bad pass, and everybody's gotta go after him. It's what it is. It's a fact. There's gonna be
bad balls. If you're gonna have a show that you listen to and personalities like Shane, myself, and Aldo that are gonna just tell the truth, there is gonna be no bias towards Mitchell. If we go back in time, Phil's draft with this team would look completely different. There'd be some possible players that are here that would be on my team that I would choose, but not a lot. Deshaun Watson would have been my pick, period, end of story, as you all know. Matt Leiner.
All right, you got to tell people what that means.
Swinging a miss.
They're not a bar fly. They don't know.
Aldo, could you tweet that out? That might make the dumbest tweets of the year. Just so I have something to look back at.
Back in the day when we were doing the draft coverage here, the expert draft coverage that we do, Aldo did not want a quarterback. He wanted a safety named Adams.
Jamal Adams.
And great player, whatever. Well, anyway, we're going through our quarterbacks, and me and Lauren Cox are in love with Deshaun Watson. Jose, I can't remember. He's in love with everybody. And then Shane is in love with Kaiser, but understands Watson. And in the fucking mock, live mock, Shane picks Watson over Kaiser, who he loved. It was craziness.
Yeah.
But Aldo comes flying in the quote of the night. You guys really like Watson? He reminds me of Matt Leiner. You are an idiot.
It was the frame rate on his throws, Bill.
Yeah, it was the fact that he didn't have any zip in his throws. I saw that you know, and the fact that he threw a lot of effing interceptions, too. Now, the final book on Deshaun Watson has not been written yet. So we'll
none of them. That's a point we got to make. That motherfucker, yeah. Michael Davids, what is his name? Pro Football.
Yeah, I know who you're talking about and what he
said. So he comes out with this fucking commentary today. Mm-hmm. I gotta confront him. The pussy doesn't even respond. I don't like fucking dudes in the media that look, if someone has a blue check mark, then they could play coy and go back and forth. Fuck you. Fuck you, Michael David fucking pussy ass. That is the bullshit he's talking about. Oh, the Bears should have just took Watson. And then he's rambling off like the story's over. Yeah. What?
We need a
write the book. Guess who's fucking playing? Pinky horseman, horse-smelling
motherfucker.
Sorry.
Yeah, that's the thing. Barrett Sally did the same thing. He's like, the Chicago Bears drafted Mitch Trubisky. They actually did that. They actually drafted him over Deshaun Watson. That actually happened.
You, sir, are an idiot.
It's shit like that. You know what I mean? They have the story written on this kid as soon as he was drafted. And, and that's the – I've been guilty of that. There's guys that I – Phil, you talked about it on BHL last night. What was my take on Johnny Manziel? I could not stand the kid. And Phil and I wasted hours – this kid, you don't know. He's got.
Let me hear you imitate me. Go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Well, you know, guys.
No, that's the nerd.
Oh, I know. That's what you sound like to me. But but no,
This dude can play.
None of.
Hear me saying that.
None of you guys put it perfectly. The story is not written on any of these guys. And just like Phil said, who's playing right now? Trubisky's playing. Deshaun Watson has his second major knee reconstruction in 4 years. You don't think that would be talked about if he was the you know what would happen if he did that in Chicago? Ryan Pace fucking drafted another Kevin White. Fucking Pace. You know, fucker's injured. That's what it is.
I would probably be one of those people. I gotta
sure.
Be like, motherfucker. Yeah. No, because I wanted the guy. I wouldn't do that.
Yeah, but it's just.
But
it's,
you're right. You would hear that from fucking Mully and fucking Hanley.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I mean, he showed great signs of explosiveness. But,
yeah.
You know, he's hurt. So that's that. That's Ryan Pace format.
Mully and Hanley putting it on Ryan Pace because DeAndre Houston Carson got a fucking holding penalty on Tariq Cohen's run back.
It's his fault, bro.
Hottest take I've ever read in my life. That's all right. That's on Ryan Pace. He drafted him. Oh. He got the holding penalty. Fucking dope.
Oh, my God. Fans believe that. And some trailer park guy who loves football. He doesn't
Let's leave Dustin out of this.
Let's pause for identification.
You're listening to the Barkeep, the smartest man in the room, and my hubby, Draft Dr. Phil.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He's the smartest man from New York to Japan. It's Christmas time. And he's the mailman. So technically makes him Santa. So his dumbest tweet of the week. Saint Nick.
I give it a C+. You got to take it all the way. You got to take it all the way to the end of the music to get a B+.
I only go two bars with my lyric.
Yeah, I know.
Limerick. Isn't that a limerick?
You fill it in with laughter and ball busting or whatever. Shane,
you guys are hard graders.
Yeah. Well, you know, you've given us some A-plus work, and so we're spoiled. Shane, what do you got?
So, yes, our dumbest tweets of the week this week, guys, they're going to be a little bit similar, but they're playing off literally what we just talked about. These are going to be some hot Mitchell Trubisky takes that Phil talks about, the blue check marks, those little fuckers, and Adam Hill VRJ. He's got one of those blue checks. And he sent out a tweet.
Oh, Adam Hill. I know this tweet.
Yeah. He sent out his hot take of Sunday was, boy, I love all the let Trubisky throw tweets every single week. Well, there's a reason they don't let him throw. You know why? It's because he's not good at throwing the football. Like, not at all. Okay. Oh, what the fuck? At what point when you're typing in your characters into Twitter, do you think that's... I mean, Jesus Christ. Mitch Trubisky's not good at throwing the football. According to whom? And this is exactly what we're talking about. Mitch Trubisky threw three interceptions versus Detroit. So the book has been written.
How many interceptions has he thrown on the year?
Seven.
How many interceptions did he throw the week before?
Zero.
And the week before that?
Who was that the week before? Was it one?
No, I can't zero. Remember.
Was
he didn't throw any. Shane is on point 100%, Shane. These guys are looking for a story. They want to write a narrative.
Exactly. Even in Chicago, we saw it. And I referred to Mully and Hanley. And it's hard not to get caught up in the hype. The Bears went out and put one on Cincinnati. Well, guys, Cincinnati is not a good team. They have their own turmoil to deal with the Marvin Lewis situation and a lot of people not
imagine being them. Imagine being them.
Yeah.
Like John Fox for 12 years, Aldo.
15. You've been there 15 years,
15,
man.
15, oh my God.
Yeah. But this plays into, like I said, exactly what we're talking about, and it's the thing that drives me nuts. And you can draft a player, and if you don't like the guy, he can go out there and he can play his first snap of in the NFL, and if he drops the football, he fucking sucks. That's it. He dropped it. It's over. The fucking guy sucks. And like Phil said, if you have a blue check mark next to your name, there's a lot of people out there that buy into that, and it's just there's a whole lot of behind the scenes work and preparation and Jeff Dickerson put out the Bears are still waiting for Mitch Trubisky to make that monumental leap this year. Well, that doesn't come in year one, Jeff. You fucking idiot. You're going to see that leap if he's going to take it. It's normally going into year two and year three where they really start to separate themselves. He's not going to automatically just get better production-wise when the Bears are really falling apart around him. I mean, with the lack of talent and a ill-prepared offensive coordinator and a head coach that's already packed it in is heading to Marco Island. So
amen.
I kind of got a little bit off course here for Mr. Hill, but it's just more of the same. Like Aldo said, this story has not been written. If Mitch Trubisky goes out and throws four interceptions against the Cleveland Browns, yes, it's not a great look, but it also doesn't mean that Mitch Trubisky is a horrible quarterback moving forward. There's a lot of it that goes into that, being a quarterback in the NFL, and that's you can't be so short-sighted.
I was 8 years old. My uncle Larry Pasquale was coaching the New York Jets, and Richard Todd, or Ken O'Brien, one of those Jet quarterbacks, threw like three or four picks, and I was a little kid. And I was like, wow, he's a bad quarterback. And I always remember my uncle saying to me, no, he's a good quarterback that had a bad day. And that stuck with me for a long time because everybody's getting paid to do their job. And sometimes mistakes are going to occur and somebody's going to be a little bit better or a little bit less than themselves, whatever it is on either side. And we're going to write a story now. I know I was the loudest in the room about this because of my feelings on what I saw on tape about Jay Cutler and the narrative. If I didn't warn you that they were going to do this shit with Mitchell Trubisky, then just let it be known again. If we have to pull Nikki, could go pull that audio back in August when I talked about that. Because it's happening, guys. That guy, I remember tweeting Adam Shane. I was like, Adam, and Jack went up a hill. Because that's the dumbest, queerest fucking thing you could say if you thought you knew anything about football.
And with that, we
do this. That was a great drop there.
It was.
Oh, yeah.
Bears, girl, leave me alone. We're trying to record. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh. He's the guy who calls out the shitty tweet in a piss contest with Danahy. He can't be beat. This is the smartest man's second dumbest tweet.
There you go. That's
what I'm not even.
Oh, A+, motherfucker.
That's what I'm talking about.
I'm not even wearing orange pants, Phil.
Oh, I can't wait.
So
spoil it.
Yeah. The second dumbest tweet is from an old friend of ours, but it's somebody that's making their first appearance
on this
show. But it's somebody that we are all familiar with. We're familiar with, and he's a fucking genius himself. And this is at Hub Arkish. I think everybody knows
the hoop.
The hoop earring one. He sent out a tweet on Saturday after the game, and Hub tweeted, "Accuracy is supposed to be one of Mitch Trubisky's greatest assets, but he's been off today, and it appears to me that he has been regressing in that area as the season has gone on. This is something to watch closely the final 2 weeks of the season." Well, when Hub sent that out, it just made me go back and look up a couple of things, and Mitch Trubisky finished the game. Yes, he was off on some passes, but he finished the game 31 of 46 for 67.4%. Last week versus Cincinnati, Mitch was 25 of 32 for 78.1% accuracy. And the week before that, Mitch was 12 of 15 for 80%. So not really sure what type of math Hub is employing here, saying that he's actually regressing with his accuracy. Yes, maybe he's passed a little bit more lately, so he has had some passes sail. But if you're going to tell me that the accuracy numbers just have not been there and he's regressing with that over the season, we all
Shamed.
Good under nuclear attacker. Is that buzzing noise? Is that Phil charging his phone, Aldo?
It must be. I don't, because it's not on.
No, it wasn't me.
Somebody fucking Russians, I guess.
Fucking Yugoslavians.
Maybe Jose Cotto is trying to tap in and listen to us, Phil.
Jose.
So, Hub saying that the accuracy numbers are regressing. Well, I mean, in terms of his percentages, that's not true. And I think it's just more of the same to go off the first tweet. I think, you know, the Bears aren't winning, and they certainly laid an egg in Detroit. And at the end of the day, the quarterback's going to probably get more love than he needs and take more hate than he deserves when they do lose. But, yeah, Hub Arkush, you are the winner of the second dumbest tweet of the week. And I'm actually kind of surprised that he hasn't been more of a factor in this segment all season long. So maybe, Hub, maybe you can step up your game here versus Cleveland, and we'll get a couple good ones for you.
We have a message for Mr. Hub Arkush here.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. May God have mercy on you.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, Aldo's making me laugh. In a handsome contest with Aldo and Phil, he's the guy who comes in third. But give him credit, he'll call out every lock and for a tweet. Absurd. It's the dumbest tweet of the week.
Oh, the best tweet of the week.
Yeah, oh, the best.
The best.
It's the best tweet of the week.
This is perfect if Phil would actually butcher this and where I'm going to go with this.
Oh, shit.
Oh, here we go. The best.
The best tweet
you
of the week.
Go and save the best for last.
Well, this is a monumental day here at Bears Barroom, 100 proof.
Oh, we need
and for
some
my
music.
Segment here. This is.
All right,
hold on. Can I get it? Yeah. As much as this fucking pains me to my core, I just want our fans to know this fucking hurts me, Aldo. Okay. This brings me to my knees and pains me that this little fuck. I have to praise him. Oh, God damn.
No.
All right. People may know this guy, fucking diva that he is. Dr. Phil Ottochian.
Wait,
motherfucker.
Am I fucking getting a fucking Marsaw?
Yes. You're getting a
pains
Marsaw.
Me.
Holy shit.
Pains
before
me.
New Year's?
I wanted to leave work early today because I'm like, this can't be the only good tweet. No fucking way.
Oh, fucking God. Hold on. I gotta sit. Oh.
Let me make sure I'm recording.
Go ahead. Go
Phil,
ahead.
don't fall off your booster seat. Jesus Christ.
That's little Nicky's. I gave it to you.
Yes. 2 days ago, draft Dr. Phil, and this is going to go in line with our little Mitch Trubisky segment here. I got to throw my boy some love as much as it pains me, but Phil tweeted out, I'm going to send this tweet to you, Mitch Trubisky, at mtrubisky10, because this city and their media love to point fingers to the wrong places. Keep getting up. Mistakes are going to happen. You keep slinging it and stepping up in the pocket and delivering. Football people know what you're dealing with. And Phil, that is a good tweet. I gotta.
Shit.
Yep.
That's
I know.
A fucking great tweet. What are you talking about?
So let's just cut it off there, and we'll move on to our next segment.
Ring the alarm.
We lost transmission.
Yep.
Since I'm the first ever live recipient.
Yes.
Can I give a speech?
Oh, hell no!
No, this is where you shut the fuck up and I gotta praise you a little bit more.
Go ahead.
But no, it really plays into everything. And guys, we lived through this with Jay Cutler. And yes, Jay had his warts. Sorry, AC, if you're listening. He wasn't perfect.
It's White Boy Wednesday, Jay.
Right.
This is airing.
Yeah, yeah, well, Jay is white, so is Mitch. So,
she
Phil, are you white?
Pumps.
Yeah, Phil, everybody thinks Phil's black, but anyways.
Oh, they do.
I know. But no, it really was a good tweet just for the simple fact because you can see it really lets you kind of in to see how fickle this entire process is with the media and fans going back to what we talked about. last week, oh, Cincinnati, Mitch, you know, we got our franchise quarterback. This is why we traded up one spot for him. You know, he's the guy. He's our savior. He goes out and you lose to Detroit. He throws three interceptions and it's Ryan Pace is a fucking idiot. If he would have stayed where he was at number three, he could have just drafted Deshaun Watson and the rest would be history.
Mm-hmm.
But Mitch isn't going anywhere. Mitch is going to be the quarterback for the Chicago Bears for at least the next 4, 5, 6, 7 years. They're going to give him every chance to fail. And it really is. It's tough to see these guys going through things like that and stuff getting thrown at them that really isn't warranted when all of this is just part of the process. So I gotta throw my boy some love here for stepping up and sending out that tweet. It made a lot of sense. So I do have to recognize him for that, Aldo, as much as it does pain me.
Well, it pains me too.
I'm surprised it took you this long to pick one of my fucking tweets. I've been stacking them.
Stay tuned.
It is true.
The cult. Stay tuned. The cult I have.
Shane. Yeah. Yes, it's true. It's a cult. Yeah. We're called the Boilermakers. Right, Aaron.
I just got it. This guy is so fucking brilliant. How does Shane not have more followers? I just recognize this today.
How many followers does Shane have?
This is fucking ridiculous.
I couldn't even tell you. What do I have?
He should have more than that. The
I'm
fact
looking it
that
up. I have 1,339 followers.
Well, that's not
that's gone up. It's gone up, but it's not where it should be.
Yeah, it should
so
be.
So barflies need to unite.
Yeah, let's everybody retweet Shane's next tweet, which is probably going to be busting Phil's balls on something.
Yeah. No, honestly, I appreciate Shane of pointing out a beautiful tweet from our team.
Yep.
I'm a team. This is Bears Barroom team. In all seriousness, Shane is one of the fucking most analytical, straight to the fucking truth point. And really, I'm sorry, even in my own grand moment of winning a fucking Marsaw, I gotta say, more people should be following this fucking guy because
yes.
He calls it out like it is. I mean,
that's right, Brad Childress. Fucking, fuck that, Frankie. I told you.
You fucking called out Frankie. You called out Rabbit. You call out Lockefora daily. I mean, come on.
Well,
that's my goal by January 31st, Shane has to be over 2,020. No, 2,122. Got to throw the double deuces in there, Aldo.
No, I like it. Sure. Maybe we
can get
an endorsement from what's that guy's name over at bearsbarroom.com? Larry Mayer. Yeah. Maybe.
Yeah. Can.
Lunch with Larry Mayer.
Sounds like a new song, right? follow Wazram.
Is this not a fucking barroom classic?
It's a classic. There's no doubt about it.
Unite lunch with Larry Mayer. Nothing could be gayer. Lunch with Larry. Potato, he's a tot and not a tater. Jesus Christ, there's some don't know his purpose. Accompanied men won't hurt us. Oh, lunch with
questions for free. No charge for a shout out. No charge for a shout out. No charge for a shout out. You're a bird fly, so screw the Bears brothers. Lunch with Larry Mayer. I can't believe he stays there. He's got eye black on, but he's not a player.
Not a player.
Jesus Christ, their son. Official site is embarrassing. There's no way of defending it when the Barroom knows more than they did. Jesus Christ, they suck. So lunch with Larry Mayer. Couldn't think of anything gayer. No disrespect to anyone who's gay here. Barflies unite.
Brilliant. Brilliant work.
Brilliant. Oh my God. There's so many nuggets in there, Aldo.
Oh my gosh.
And you know what?
I wrote a whole lyric for you, Shane, in there.
I still don't want Larry Mayer's autograph, even though I thought I did.
Oh, yeah, you're talking to me. Where do you want me to sign, young man?
Give me your pen. Give me your pen. No, I'm good, man.
Shane's digging in his pocket. Yeah. I got no pen.
You know,
did you feel bad for him in that moment?
It was really awkward. I had just got to the stadium, and we were all – it was – so hot. It was actually Jay Cutler's preseason debut as a Bear. They had just traded for him that spring. And we were in Buffalo, and they put down new pavement outside in the parking lot. And it was so goddamn hot. And me and a bunch of my buddies were there. And we were all drinking a little bit too much Kool-Aid and weren't in the best of shape when we got in there. And when I ordered my tickets, I got them down behind the Bears sideline. So we were there early, and like I said, Matt Forte came over, and even Cutler was there. I was back when the Bears had just drafted Joaquin Iglesias, one of Jerry Angelo's third rounders that played one snap in the NFL. But they were all over there, and Larry Mayer came over, and I'm like, hey, Larry. He starts walking over to him. He's like, hey, hand me your pen. I'll get you an autograph. I'm like, no, I don't want your autograph. I was just saying, hey, Larry. It was definitely awkward, but part of me was laughing at Zach. I'm like, what would I want his autograph for?
Oh, man. So, that's why we had this song was inspired by Shane, let me just tell you. Because me and him for years are like, do you have a website? And yeah, it's total access. You could do so much. Look what we're doing at the Barroom. Just our film breakdowns when we've had them, and our analysis here, and reaching out and breaking it down. Imagine you had full access to everything and what they do. And then the Larry Mayer aspect of it, and lunch with Larry. Right. And he's got the eye black on. And Shane and I would just laugh. So I had
cutting
to put
edge.
That in the lyric. He's got eye black on, but he's not a player.
Yeah, like Eagles.com put out a thing this week following around John DeFilippo around, because they're essentially promoting this guy.
To get his name
out there. That's what this is all about. And he's going to be on everybody's hiring list. So I watch it, and I'm like, here we are, you know, poor Bears fans, we get fucking lunch with Larry, and Philadelphia's out there, you know, pubbing their coaches to get them promoted and, you know, give them exposure. And we get a guy that's sitting there eating, telling us what he's eating for lunch, a pulled pork sandwich or whatever the fuck he happens to be pulling under the table, and just doing softball questions. And it's just exactly what we should come to expect from the Chicago Bears at this point. But, man, it is sad.
Well, that's why we have a responsibility here at the Barroom is to make fun of these guys, to make some noise. And after a while, you know, things start to change because when they start feeling that they're the butt of jokes, all of a sudden they'll call Larry in and say, you either change your shtick or get out of here along with John Fox because these people are making a lot of noise and making us look stupid. You know, one of the things that I just missed an opportunity to talk to George McCaskey. When we got to Ford Field on Saturday, we unfortunately sat in the wrong seats like a bunch of fucking hoo-has. It's like... The first series of the game is going on, and all of a sudden people come, hey, you're sitting in our seats. And we're like, fuck you. These are our seats. And then lo and behold, we were wrong. We were actually had better seats. And once we moved to the new seats, the guy that was seated next to us says, yeah, you guys just missed George McCaskey. I'm like, fuck, that would have been my opportunity to let him know, you know, about John Fox, fire Larry Mayer, fire the whole fucking website team.
Put down the filter.
I would have started off
here's
by saying,
CD.
"Yeah." I would have started off by saying, "Hey, George, you and I worked at Channel 2 together. You were in the newsroom writing. I was in the programming department,
right.
And then you know, build a little camaraderie. And then I would have put my arm around them and said, listen, brother, you better fire that John Fox on Black Monday, or I'm going to go
Bears,
over."
Bears girl comes around the other side to take a picture, slides a CD in his fucking pocket.
That would have been classic. That would have been classic.
Do you think George's Toyota Camry plays CDs, Phil?
Yeah.
The problem is
he's
he doesn't
listening
want
to
work
to fucking Cosby, Stills, and Nash right now.
All right. Listen, guys, we have a new segment. Phil, you want to introduce it with a little, what are we calling this? Pussy of the Week?
Steak and whiskey.
Steak and whiskey.
It's going to be our steak and whiskey segment. You know what? We obviously have fun here on the show. Trey Bizzy came on the show, really knocked it out of the park. We had a lot of fun with him. And one thing was evident, that Trey doesn't mince words and loves the F-bomb. And we love it here on this adult show. And I know you do, too. And... we wanted to ask Trey, you have a job. And I go, Trey, I need you to really watch Twitter and see who's a bitch-ass punk that doesn't understand their role as a person that's responsible for telling the truth and writing and doing news about this football team. And basically, Trey was talking on the last show about how these writers are so stuffy that they just need a little pussy in their life. And it's so evident. So we said that needs to be a segment every week. Trey, much like Shane is finding these dumb tweets, is going to need to find the guy or girl who needs pussy this week.
Could be a guy, could be a girl, could be an animal.
Yeah, the Bears blog might be a runaway winner with this segment.
Yeah. Bears Barroom, 100 proof. Steak and whiskey. The Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey.
Whiskey, whiskey.
That Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey. That Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey. That Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Who needs pussy? That Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Who needs pussy?
Come on, boss.
They all need these fans, they know they do, and they need pussy. The Bears Barroom vibe just hits me. Yeah, you love that steak and that fucking whiskey. Coming from the colonel of the bar flies busy. He looks at the frauds in the media. The ones that need and don't get pussy like chlamydia. Bears 100 proof with your man Trey Bizzy. Discover who needs pussy cause the football ticket shitty. Shytown's finest coming real on 100 proof. Working on a skyscraper, listen to the bar. Spit the truth. Waffle cone, get three scoops. A writer, not a blogger cause he could bench the weight room.
That's my boy Trey Biz, dropping truth on these suckers for the bar fly whiz kids.
Steak and whiskey, the Bears barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey, the Bears barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey, that Bears barroom vibe just hits me. Steak and whiskey,
that whiskey,
that Bears barroom vibe just hits me.
Who needs pussy?
Pussy. That Bears barroom vibe just hits me. Who needs pussy? That Bears barroom vibe just hits me.
Who in the face?
Smacks you. Smacks you down. Can't get around.
Pussy?
Need that steak and whiskey right now. Don't you think about it all the time?
Steak and whiskey, bring it back. Come on, barflies.
That barroom vibe just hits me.
And whiskey.
Yeah,
Bears barroom,
yeah, another hit for the Bears barroom.
Cause we got steak and whiskey, and you
and
don't
got
none.
My man Trey Bizzy,
oh, Trey Bizzy,
yeah.
To just feel to find
the hits,
they know
who the
hits
say.
Yeah,
they know
Bears barflies, no, they do. Barflies,
yeah,
they're so tight,
oh,
and you
yeah.
know
everything is negative.
That steak and whiskey.
Can you feel that vibe come through?
Oh, it's got a barroom
in your head.
Yeah.
So
then that steak and whiskey's true.
Can't you see?
Michael Lombardi, NFL. At on Twitter is at M Lombardi, NFL. I guess he was in the Browns organization for a few years. That tells you everything you know. He was in the Browns organization. I think he's responsible for getting them Justin Gilbert and fucking Johnny Manziel in a draft that was deep with quarterbacks. He could have got fucking Derek Carr and fucking Teddy Bridgewater, right? So this guy goes, the Bears should have stayed at number three and took Watson instead of Trubisky. What the fuck do you know about quarterbacks? You know, you brought in fucking Johnny Manziel, you fucking pussy. Really, this guy is suffering from lack of pussy. It's so, like, he hasn't had pussy in so long that it's distorting his ability to concentrate on what's right in front of him. He can't pay attention to what's going on. If we were to still have Watson right now, we would have Mike Glennon playing right now because he would tore his ACL, right?
Right.
Mike Glennon would be on the field. Throwing away interceptions like he's at the goddamn Oprah Winfrey show giving away gift baskets. And that's what we have going on right now. I mean, don't get me wrong. I think Watson's a good quarterback. He's a great quarterback. I love Trubisky. I want to see more from Trubisky. He needs to go through these things. He needs to throw these interceptions now. He needs to get the shit out the way. He needs to understand where he needs to go with the football. Where does he need to go? His read, when to let the ball go. He needs to learn it all now. You know why you got the trash ass system. Learn it now why you got trash system. So when you get in the good system, you don't have to worry about making these mistakes no more. You learn from this. Then that motherfucker need a gift card to Arnie's or the strip club out here. He need a gift card. Hey, Christmas is around the corner, man. You know, you gotta be giving mood. I'm in a giving mood. I'll give him a fucking gift card to get some pussy because he needs it.
Give me one of those gift cards.
Meanwhile, Shane's fucking baby battering every night. He's exhausted from the pussy.
You ain't kidding.
I wonder why your tweets have been fucking pristine.
Yeah. Jesus Christ.
His voice got slower.
I could tell you the best story ever.
The teaser?
Literally just happened two nights ago. But I'll have to tell you guys off air. I cannot tell it on air.
Oh my God!
I would get. I'm sorry, fans. Maybe
I thought
I'll,
you were stern.
I'm stern, but I'm not fucking stupid. I can't. If I shared this story, I would get fucking killed. Maybe if we do a New Year's Eve show and we're all drunk, maybe I'll let it slip.
Oh, we have to. Okay, here comes again. The fucking Russians are at it again.
Hoorah!
The Russians.
I got a story I'm going to share. My buddy calls me up. His name is James Kessel. He's a very successful film director here in town, and he is working with a guy on a TV variety show that's sort of like Saturday Night Live with comedy skits and stuff, except it's much more risque and R-rated, maybe X-rated in some parts. And so he was telling me that, you know, him and this guy are sitting around coming up with ideas, and James came up with an idea of a fantasy football draft that's being held by members of the KKK. And, and now this idea is copywritten, so nobody can steal this. But he was explaining it to me, and we got to have James on the show because he just tells a story so fucking funny. But he was saying that all these guys in hoods are at a bar and they're drafting all white players. And so, you know, by the end of the second round, all the kickers in the league are taken. Anyway, James Kessel will be a future guest during the slow months of the season. He'll crack us up because this guy's fucking funny. He's also a Dallas Cowboy fan, so we've got plenty to bust on his balls about.
There you go.
All right, guys. I think we should move on to Bear Up, Bear Down. What do you guys think?
Sounds good.
All right.
Yeah, yo.
We've got actually theme music for this. Should we do the long version or the short version?
Short.
And here it is.
Sorry, Phil.
Bear up, bear down. Trap Dr. Phil and the smartest men around, they're watching the tape and weighing. The game is done. The Bears have lost the one they're playing. The boys are grading.
That was a quick end. Who is first this week?
That is Mr. Ottochian is number one this
Phil,
week.
Oh, and don't forget, Phil, we start with the bear up.
Up, up.
Just like your lyric says.
Straight up now, tell me, do you really want to love Shane forever, Ela?
Man, we fucking created a monster.
I am Weird Phil. I got a weird whoever Phil. Fly that came up with that was great.
That was clever.
Yes, that was clever, yeah, and I like clever.
Weird Al, Weird Phil.
There you go.
What do you got?
That'll be my role. My other personality on this show.
Yeah, now we got to find a film analyst now. There, we got an opening at the Barroom because Phil is doing all our music. He's not analyzing film anymore. He's fucking analyzing parody tracks and music, and writing lyrics and all this stuff. It's a full time job, so we need somebody to help us analyze film. All right, brother.
Well, the Bears blog, he might come over to help analyze.
What is,
film
what is that guy's name again? Is it Andrew? Andrew Danny?
Jeff Hughes and Andrew Danny.
Oh, okay. So yeah. It's two of them, huh?
Yeah, Dumb and Dumber.
Well, they're welcome, but not to work here. They're just welcome to come on to the show so we can bust their balls. All right. Tell me who you got, Bear Up.
My bear up is going to go to a guy that just typifies a professional, goes out there, is a leader of men. You could see him cheering on his team in a loss, trying to motivate people, obviously, in an embarrassment of a season, and is a captain of this football team. And I believe got screwed the fuck over by not being in the Pro Bowl, because if there's a more dominant defensive end in a 3-4, I don't know. I just think it's a travesty, Akeem, that you didn't make the Pro Bowl. And I think it's a travesty and an embarrassment to the National Football League in a popularity contest. Let's stop letting fans vote. Let's start allowing coaches to vote. And that's it. And get it right. Or allow outside scouts to vote. People that actually know. Because Akeem Hicks is my bear up this week, Aldo. But I just, you know, the news came up tonight as we're recording that zero Bears made the Pro Bowl, as Shane, I believe, said before. And you all know how I feel about Jordan Howard and Akeem Hicks. Clear-cut Pro Bowlers to me. And really, I just don't get it, especially on Akeem. You know, Jordan Howard has some games, obviously, taken away from him by an offensive coordinator, little dumber boy, Dowell Loggins, who just doesn't get it, as we all know. He has no feel, doesn't understand. It's just guesswork, guessing. But with Akeem Hicks, this is a guy that opposing teams have to account for. I've seen him be triple teamed, and he's still making the play. If you watched him in this game, what did he have, 2 sacks? He should have had 4, and he had a few pressures in there. The guy was playing his ass off, absolutely bare up this week. And Akeem, you're very active with us, the bar room, one of those players that will respond and talk with fans. Guy is very articulate and knows his shit, knows the game, and really, he deserves to be in the Pro Bowl, Aldo.
Without a doubt. And you know what? I think he's going to eventually make it. He'll probably come in as a replacement. But the honor should have been made today when they announced the first cut, so to speak, of Pro Bowlers. But Akeem Hicks, we love you, and thanks for being a great Chicago Bear. Like Phil said, just a part of the community. Great interviews and just a hell of a guy, man. That's the kind of applause that you get nowadays, Phil, when you walk into a room, right?
Oh, my God. You should have seen these CDs. I mean, people at my job are like, you're going to run out. Are you going to get more?
We're going to do another run.
They're not even Bears fans. This is impressive, guy. I mean, I hope Barflies recognized how fortunate they are to be receiving such a tremendous gift from Aldo and Bears Girl. And no, but seriously, the job you guys did, the look of the CD, I don't want to forget to say what a great job Bears Girl and you did looking at the product. It really captures, you know, when you put your heart and soul into songs and music and lyrics, obviously there'll be a time to tell this story, but another person's in charge of bringing it to life on another platform, the presentation of it really looks sharp, Aldo, and Bears Girl, I shout you out.
She gets all the credit for that. I just stand by and wait for deliveries. All right, Shane, I understand you have a bear up. Who could it be?
Yes, sir, I do. I kind of eat a little bit of crow on my bear up this week. This is a guy that I kind of went after and trashed our GM a little bit for bringing a guy like this back into the fold, Mr. Lamar Houston.
Yeah,
good call.
Very deserving.
Gotta give Lamar. I think, you know, he's not making a ton of plays, but he is getting after the quarterback. He's got 4 sacks in his 3 games since he's been back with the Bears. And really, where would our pass rush be the last 3 games if we didn't have Lamar in there? Because he's taken advantage of some situations, and he seems to be a little more inspired than he was before. Maybe health plays into that. Maybe contract year plays into that. But it's probably a little bit of both. But he's really surprised me. And like I said, I do have to eat a little bit of crow because, you know, with us being a young team that's really going nowhere, I wanted to see them focus on somebody that was younger and see if maybe it was somebody that you could keep on your team moving forward. But Lamar himself is still only 30 years old, and he's really making a play to maybe earn himself a 1 or a 2 year deal here in Chicago to be a veteran presence in the locker room. And then somebody that a guy like, you know, Leonard Floyd and Isaiah Irving can look up to and see all of ups and downs that he's been through throughout his career, and realize that just because you're cut from one team doesn't mean that you can't come back and have really a whole new lease on life. So to Lamar Houston, you are my bear up this week.
Look at this guy, eating crow with me and Lamar.
Yep.
Wow, you've been eating a lot of crow tonight.
Yeah, it is true. And it, yeah, you know, I hear Phil was given credit to you guys doing the CDs. Aldo, we in fact talked about that. I only heard Phil complain once, saying, well, you know, they could have at least labeled the CDs with the songs on there. I mean, what the fuck? But it's not like, are we still recording?
Buffon would have gotten the song label on the CD.
That's right.
Is what Shane said.
They would have been.
He said, fucking Bears Girl. That must be the song's being labeled. Didn't make it through customs.
That's the next run, the super edition, limited edition. We'll have that labeling. All right, it is time now to do the bear down. Man, I do love this song, Phil.
Yeah?
Yeah, I really do.
I like it. I like it. My son loves it. Radio. A bear up, a bear down. It's Draft Dr. Phil and the smartest man around. A bear up, bear down. It's Draft Dr. Phil and the smartest man around. A bear up, a bear down. It's Draft Dr. Phil and the smartest man around. A bear up, a bear down. It's Draft Dr. Phil and the smartest man around. A bear up.
Man, that is really, really outstanding work, bro. That should be the soundtrack of my life, you know, because I've had some up and downs in my life.
I'm creating your soundtrack, Aldo.
There you go.
I'm going to write
a song for all of the Bears.
I know what Shane is going to say. Go ahead,
yeah,
Shane.
Yeah, sounds like your sex life right now, though.
I knew.
Where's Richard Strong when you need him?
Hawaii? Was that Hawaii?
Yeah. Yep.
He's getting laid.
We already got the crowd booing sound effect going. All right, Phil, who is your bear down?
I didn't like that joke.
No. Who is your bear down player?
Well, it's very easy for me. We should start giving this guy an award, because it's going to be the Bear Down Mike Burton Award. Because,
ooh, again, huh?
Is there, you know, I got a lot of feedback from barflies, and you could tell who really listens and loves the show and who doesn't, because they're picking up on Shane's quirks and my statements and Aldo's stuff. But the Mike Burton thing seems to be taking on a life of its own, guys, because everybody's starting to keep an eye on number 46. And when you do, nothing good comes of it. And it just showcases how putrid the offensive coordinator and the head coach, and I have to question Ryan Pace, unless they're just adamant about keeping this guy on the, I just don't get it. He is the worst fucking football player I've ever seen in this game. Again, not only is he cower on a couple plays, he also is so late to get to where he's supposed to be, and he can't do the job. And how could, you know, some fullbacks that are kind of his size and aren't the greatest bulldozing fullbacks give you something else. Mm-hmm. They give you a great receiver into the flat, and you surprise them with a couple big plays here and there. Tony Carter comes to mind, former Bear. I'm trying to think of some other guys that were full, but Brad Baxter back in the day with the Jets, he didn't kill anybody. But this guy, Aldo, he is just an albatross out there, just not a fit. He's to keep the Christmas theme going. He's on the island of misfit fullbacks for Driscoll. He is not on this fucking football team. He's just terrible, and it's just I love you all. I love when you pointed out even the plays from James Ford in Canada all the way to Mamu over there, Mamu the Bear up in Kuwait. Just recognizing that, how does this guy have a job? We had to write a song about it, for God's sake. Him and Dowell Loggins, the love affair. Again, just watching the tape for the second time was worse than the first time I watched it live. And Mike Burton, you are my bear down of the week for the third time.
Hold on a second. I'm going to cue that song up right now. Fuck, where is it? There it is. Oh, yeah.
Okay, here we go.
Oh, the fucking booing sound effect.
Papa Boohey.
Awful back. Critical situations are his call. The position is so antique, predictable every week. Up the middle or on a toss, the opponent stacked the box for another loss. And I saw Dowell loving the fullback. Antiquated offense is his call. What an amazing sight to see when the Bears wide receivers are three. Dowell, let go of Mike Burton, please. I saw Dowell loving the fullback. Critical situations are his call. The position is so antique, predictable every week. Up the middle or on a toss, the opponent stacked the box for another loss. And I saw Dowell loving the fullback. Antiquated offense is his call. What an amazing sight to see when the Bears wide receivers are three. I will let go of Mike Burton, please. Yeah.
Fucking brilliant, man. Just brilliant.
You didn't have a short version of that one?
All right, Shane, give me a bear down player and make sure we don't have a song about him.
I think we're good. This is probably going to upset some Bears fans. I'm going to go a little bit off the grid here, and I'm going to call out somebody that I had really, really high expectations for. And it's not that he's played bad, but he really hasn't made the impact that I really thought that he would get in there and make. So I'm going to go with Nick Kwiatkowski.
Really?
I am a little bit. Yep. He's been playing okay. Phil, you and I talked about this a little bit yesterday. I think he's just been okay. I don't think he's made the overall impact that I was expecting him to. Mm-hmm. I don't think he's locked down anything saying, all right, he's going to be absolutely the guy. He's not a guy that you're going to get rid of or anything like that. That's not what I'm saying. I was just expecting him to make a lot more impact plays from the inside linebacker position, even playing next to a guy like Danny Trevathan. Yes, I know that he's still a young player, but he had a couple game run here 5 or 6 games ago where he had a sack in a couple of straight games, but he's just... He had some nice tackles this past game. I think he finished maybe 7, 8, 9, right in that range. But I'm not seeing those big impact plays from Kwiatkowski, even like we did last year, where he's going in, he's you know, blowing guys up in the hole and sacking the quarterback and tipping passes. So I'm not down on the player. I'm expecting a little bit more. So I want to see Nick Kwiatkowski step up his game a little bit and really take hold of this position moving forward into 2018. So I'm going to throw a little bit of shade your way, Nick. Number 44, one of the best numbers on the football field, by the way.
I love that number.
Especially absolutely. A linebacker. I love
yep.
it.
Mm-hmm. So, like I said, not down on the player, but I'm expecting a little bit more. I have a really usually a lot of praise for the kid, and I expect a lot from him. So he's not up to my high standards that I'm holding for him quite yet. So I just want to see him do a little bit more.
Yes. Aldo.
Go ahead.
Did you think Shane was going to pick Mike Nugent? Because that's what I thought.
I did.
No, I didn't go with special teams. Actually, I was gonna.
You're going to get O'Donnell.
No, I was going to go the whole thing, how poor Tariq Cohen's been getting fucked over.
Oh, yes. God.
Yes.
Unbelievable. Oh, I've never seen anything like it.
Can we stay there for a second so I don't forget, because I forgot last night.
Sure.
Tariq Cohen. Shane brought him up. Olin Krutz and I got into it. You know, I'm a big believer in coaching. We devoted a lot of time to that. So short version here. Here's another coaching complete whopper of an error. You know, if you don't know what the whopper is, I don't know what to tell you. In America, it's a Burger King, their biggest burger. This is the biggest blunder of the Bears in watching them and how they use players. In no lifetime, in no world, do you take a dynamic playmaker off the football field, okay? But even the mortal sin worse than this is taking a dynamic football player off the field on third down. And to put Benny motherfucking Cunningham in there as if Benny Cunningham is something special. I know he scored a touchdown, Phil, blah, blah, blah. Tariq Cohen could put his face into someone's chest and pick. He's picked up many a blocks. And if you challenge me, I'll fucking go through the tape and put them all up there. And he's not missed a block. So that knock, throw that shit out there. That don't fucking work with me. If that's what you're going to do, he can't pick up the blitz. I'm asking him to be a weapon on third down and be in the backfield and create mismatches. Coaching error. Jordan Howard's going to be there, then this kid got to be on the football field at slot. He has to be a part of your third down package on some level. Josh Bellamy, no. I just wanted to make sure that the mortal sin of stupidity when it comes to coaching is leaving your playmakers off the field when it matters most. And third down is a critical down. And there's been many of them consumed by Benny Cunningham.
And one more quick thing that I'll wedge in here about Tariq Cohen. The Athletic put out a little blurb about Tariq and all the yards that he's had taken away from him. And it says, Tariq Cohen has had 241 yards negated by penalties season so far. If Cohen was his own team, he would rank 13th in the NFL in nullified yards. Think about that. The Chicago Bears team have nullified more Cohen yards this season than 20 NFL teams have for their entire roster. Think about that.
Shane, he's a Division III player. He can't do it.
Yeah, right.
This is all black college. You can't. Phil, it was a wasted pick.
You and I talked about Tariq for, 15, 20 minutes yesterday when we were chatting on the phone. Mm-hmm. There. Think about what this kid would be doing in New England or in an offense like Philly.
He would be the toast of the town.
He'd be up for rookie of the year. He'd never leave the field.
Do you think Belichick?
Oh my
wouldn't
God.
Use this fucking kid like a fucking dynamo. Are you kidding me? We got fucking panhandle fucking Dowell. Dumber boy.
Hey, let me ask you a question, Phil. Would you trade Tariq Cohen for Christian McCaffrey right now?
Hell no.
Serious?
Hell no.
Dude, white running backs, I fucking wouldn't take in the first round ever.
Wait a minute. If you were in that fantasy football league with the KKK, you would have to take him.
He'd be our first fucking pick.
Yeah.
No, Brady would be my house.
Oh,
come
yeah.
on.
Of course. Yeah. Hey, all right, guys. I think we're going to close the show a little early tonight. What do you think? We're at an hour and 45
Yay!
Minutes.
You mean we're not going to go another hour and a half?
Like we're 2 hours in, I thought.
Oh, my goodness. All right, guys. Here comes the closing theme music. Do we have some shout-outs today? Let's keep the shout-outts short. Hold on. What's going on?
Then we just can shout out me and Nikki. Then I guess.
Yeah. Hey, we got to shout out our former colleague, Lauren Cox, graduated from junior high school this past weekend.
Whoa!
I don't know if you guys saw that. Actually, no, Lauren graduated from Wisconsin. So
nice. Props, way to go, Lauren.
Props to Mr.
Congrats.
Cox.
I didn't see that. He's graduated already?
Yeah, he just graduated this past Saturday. I saw his picture on Twitter. Him and his girlfriend still. He still lassoed her somehow. She's still with him. So
he's Nutella'd her.
Yeah, Coxie's got the graduation papers and a hot girl. So he's doing a lot better than some of us.
Yeah, he's gone.
Has he gotten a haircut yet?
No, he's still a hairbag.
Shaggy do.
Hey, I got to give a shout out to a gentleman by the name of Art Galikowski. He has been listening to the show on YouTube. We usually get about 50 to 60 people listening to us on YouTube. And Art is very, very thankful for the work that we do. He wrote, Bears Barroom, thank you for your show. Thank you for all of the work that you're doing. I'm telling all of my friends about this show. Merry Christmas. And so, Art, you are stepping up in the pocket and delivering. So thank you very much for that.
Thanks, Art.
Appreciate that, Art.
Art Galikowski. I don't think he's on Twitter. I think his world is YouTube, and that's cool. We love you, Art, and thanks for listening, and thanks for sharing the news about the show with others.
Absolutely. That's what the barflies are supposed to be doing.
That's right.
Going on all the platforms to get the message out.
And if you
don't know if there's a better podcast out there, guys. I'm sorry. I'm just going to lay down the truth.
Well, if there is, you know, let us know so that way we could steal their ideas.
Yeah, exactly. Give us an upcoming guest list so we know who to schedule, right? Exactly.
Phil, you got a shout out or two?
Oh, yeah. I got a shout out, guys, that step up in the pocket. You know, that's my thing. I just, you know, we did this Christmas bash. The CDs are out in the mail, right, Shayne and Aldo?
Yes, sir.
There you go.
I got mine on Saturday when I was off in the morning. I had a couple hours. I took my son to the new Star Wars movie, and when we got back, I had a little package there from Mr. Gandia, and I'm like, what the hell is this? And I'm like, oh, fucking more music from Phil.
That's funny.
Hey, I'm growing a cult, Shayne. Fan base, followers worldwide.
Yeah.
But I got to shout them out, though. Nelson Daniels.
Nelson is awesome.
Talk
man.
About barfly that fucking doesn't back down. I'll put him at fullback. He'll put his fucking face into somebody, right?
We've got barflies all over the place volunteering to play on your team. They want to be the backup quarterback.
Yeah,
they want to hold the clipboard. They want to be offensive linemen, linebackers. You should be a college football coach because you could easily recruit a top 10 team, man.
Trey Bizzy was talking to me tonight after we recorded. He's like, Phil, I know you want me at outside linebacker, but I want to play strong safety. I go, you know what? I'm going to come up with a roster for the new year.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
In the offseason, a barfly roster.
I love it. I love
it. 53-man roster.
Nikki can be Tony Medlin. Hey, we gotta actually shout out a Bears player, Kyle Long. Got that shoulder surgery today.
All right.
So
let's put that shit to end.
That's actually a really important thing. You know, we wanted him to get that a little earlier so we can have him moving forward into the 2018, because hopefully he's ready to go, because he can be an integral part if he's healthy. So
absolutely. Breaking news. Nikki throwing it out there as you're talking about him. How about Jay Mueller? What's Wolf? Zach Cycle? I know Aldo wants me to keep it quick, but I love you guys. B. Diddy. How big has B. Diddy? Connecticut boys representing. How about that, Aldo?
Big
fucking
time.
Connecticut stepping up. Big James time. Ford. Mark in Dubai. Jeff Jersey. Disgruntled Bear fan. Sandy Toms. How about Stacy Hefner?
Stacy.
How about Cal Brooks? How about my boy Haitian kid, Teddy? I haven't shouted him out. He was reaching out this week, promoting the podcast and promoting what we do here. Momo.
Hey.
George T. Ray, John Boy, Chris Teichler, Eddie G. You guys step up. Johnny Buffone. How about John Buffone?
Johnny.
What a fucking barfly that guy is.
Yes, sir. Right.
He's singing my fucking song on stage in the fucking TV room.
Hey, you guys want a little Bears related breaking news here?
Yes,
on Twitter?
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Fuck, Mr. what are we doing?
This is one of those guys that's got one of those little blue check marks next to his name, Benjamin Albright. Oh. I think we all know who he is.
Oh, he's, yeah.
A lot of yeah. things he's right on and some he's wrong on, but he tweeted out two teams with head coach openings coming. Have Chief Special Teams Coach Dave Taub at or near the top of their interview list.
Mm-hmm.
And the two teams, Chicago. The Indianapolis Colts and the Chicago Bears.
That's a good interview.
There you go.
That's a good interview.
I like Ben. I want, for the record, there is going to be a surprise to Barflies. It's going to be epic in the new year. Our next week's show, Aldo, we are going to release the secret track. And ooh. Ben Albright makes an appearance, Shane, in it. So
there you
I
go.
Gotta get Ben. Ben, I used to think, was playing the game that Matt Miller and Aaron Lemming play, Shane.
No.
I know you can analytically do it, but I gotta say, as I've studied Ben, I have respect for him, and I just wanna make sure that's there. And I'm gonna offer him an opportunity to come on the show with us, Albert.
Yeah, if he misses anything he does, he owns up to it immediately. Yeah, I mean, he can respect that shit. Yep, he can come across as a smarmy little bitch sometimes, like most of us can, but at least he will own up to it, and he has been right on more times than not on a lot of stuff. I never used to be an Albright fan initially, but he's grown on me a little bit.
Yeah, he's a good guy.
Me too.
Hey, I got some announcements to make here. We are doing a Christmas Day special that is going to be on MixLR, and it will play throughout the day, and then we'll post it onto your podcast stream so that you can have access to it throughout the Christmas week. And basically, that show is going to be Draft Dr. Phil Ottochian is going to be interviewed by a celebrity barroom. Celebrity barroom host, I guess we would say that person is. So that's going to be a lot of fun. We're also going to have some other surprises in that show. And I'm not going to give any away. I'm not even going to give hints. I'm just going to tell you that it's going to be a couple of hours of just great music. Phil sharing his inspiration for some of these songs and also commenting on the football angle of these songs. It's going to be fantastic. We're also going to talk a little bit about the CD winners and where they're from. I mean, we got people from all over the world who are winners. You know what the postage fee is that I got to pay to send these things?
You know how much it costs to send
John Bradley and Chris Bowden.
Exactly.
Sandy Tom.
Exactly.
Those are my boys. I got to shout them out too.
It's too bad you didn't know somebody that works in for the post office, Aldo.
I know, Aldo.
Yeah. Why didn't
you
we send these
sent
to
them
you?
To Shane? Then Shane sends them out. What are we fucking doing, Aldo?
Motherfucker.
Where's
motherfucker,
Uncle Roscoe?
Motherfucker sending me packages from UPS to my doorstep. Fucking blasting me.
Hey, it's Uncle Roscoe. Are you fucking saving any money for this shit thing? Hey.
That's hilarious. That is hilarious. Your Christmas gift is coming via FedEx, by the way.
He's sending everybody.
Did you get the Marsaw Christmas card, Aldo? In the mail yet?
I got it.
No,
I
never opened my mail, man.
Oh, jeez. So you didn't get the Ottochian one yet, Aldo?
Somebody else at the house here opens the mail, and my wife has been out of town for the last 2 weeks.
Hey, let me ask you.
Yes, sir.
Does the stepdaughter live in the house with you?
Yeah, she's going to University of Iowa, and so when she's not in school.
The Hawkeyes.
Yeah, she is a Hawkeye fan.
We got some big Barfly Hawkeye fans. I grew up being an Iowa Hawkeye fan.
Is that right?
You loved
Hayden
Fry.
Yeah, that was my team.
He loved that pink locker room, that pink visitor's locker room in Iowa.
Hayden Fry. He was the head coach, man.
Yeah,
he always wore the sunglasses.
Head coach, man. Listen, I was a young kid. I just loved the Iowa Hawkeyes and the Chicago Bears. Everyone was like, what the fuck? You live in Connecticut and Brooklyn, New York. You like the fucking Iowa Hawkeyes? But, yeah, I grew up. My camp counselor in football camp. Tyrone Berry, I'll never forget him. He was a football player from Mount Vernon High School in New York. Tremendous linebacker. Went to the University of Iowa, and he was our camp counselor. He was just like the fucking coolest guy I'd ever met in my life. I was like in awe of him. He just came in with his shades and fucking playing the Fat Boys and Run DMC. And I'm like, this guy is unbelievable. And then my love affair and interest went to Iowa, and then I studied them, and the rest is history. But that's cool that she goes to Iowa.
Yeah, she loves it there. It's been a great experience for her.
Good-looking girl, Aldo. A lot of Barflies are fans.
Hey, let me tell you something.
I got a lot of DMs like, wait, is that Aldo's girl? Is that Aldo's daughter? Is she single?
If you're talking about the young lady that was with me at the Lions game, that is my biological daughter. I made that.
Oh, that's what we're talking.
Yes.
That's what we're talking about.
That's Kayla.
That's the biological.
Yes. And
we're talking Kayla.
She lives in the city. She's got her own place in the city. She's living the life. She's a school teacher. My stepdaughter goes to the University of Iowa, and she's also another beauty that I have not shared any pictures with because her mom would kick my ass.
No, sorry. We're talking about Kayla.
Kayla.
Shout out
correct.
To Kayla.
Kayla loves shouts out too, man. She had such a great time at Ford Field.
Was she feeling the fulfilled tracks?
Oh my gosh, we played them in the car, and she was really into them. And then after the third one, she goes, "Okay, let's listen to something else."
Oh, I'm a big Kayla fan. Tell her I'm a big Kayla fan.
Fucking guys played the CD 12 times. Hila's texted DMing me. She's like, "He won't stop playing your music."
Yeah. A couple of other quick things about what we're doing. Stop over to bearsbarroom.com. Frustrating moments in Bears history. Brett Malley really hit one out of the park with his recollection of the Rick Meyer trade. I mean,
Oh my God.
I mean,
I remember Shane's reaction that.
Could have had Walter
dialogue.
Jones.
Wasn't it dialogue?
Could have had Walter Jones.
Could have had Walter Jones. Yep.
1996 or 7?
97.
When they traded for
it? Yep.
97. Remember the dial-up? We're on the message board.
Yeah.
That's right.
I was like, I don't know. I hope Rick Meyer's going to be good. Wow.
And Phil pointed out in a tweet that Don Banks had written a story that is of special interest to Chicago Bears fans with the impending coaching change, and we got permission to run that story by Don Banks on the website. It's the title is Rams Jaguars Turnaround Display Value of NFL Coaching. It's a very well done story by Don Banks, and we're hoping to have him on the show to talk about that story and just talk about coaching in general in a future show in a week or two. And I think that's all we got going, fellas. Let me tell you that if you drink, please don't drive, especially this holiday season with so many crazies out there. And remember to always bear down.
Bear down.
Merry Christmas, motherfucker.